say anything you have to say or talk. Hopefully we can give you some interesting information, and if you've got questions, hopefully we can even answer some of those. What we're going to do is we've got Jeff Dare, our operations manager, and Ken, our commissioner's here as well. So Jeff's going to talk a little bit about electric system reliability and service, electric service for the area. And Dan's going to talk a little bit about financial situation at the PUD and things we've been working on and where we're going. And then I'll kind of wrap up with a little bit about budgets, rates, what's going to happen, I think, for a little bit of future. And if you've got questions, we can address those. With that, Jeff.
Do you guys mind if I sit up here? I'm going to sit down, guys, and just stand up again. So, like Jeff said, my name is Jeff Lair. I am the operations manager at the utility. Responsible for the crews, the operations of the water wastewater systems and the electric side. Trust me, I don't do it all. I have some really, really good people that work with me, and they take care of things really well as far as I'm concerned. First thing I want to talk about tomorrow night, most of you know, hopefully you all know, there's an outage tomorrow night from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. on Saturday morning. The reason for that outage is DPA requested an outage on the main transmission line that feeds the Dallasport, what we call the Spearfish substation. And while they're taking that out, it's that same line feeds the Lyle substation, which feeds into Hyperion. And so anytime that they're taking an outage on the system, we like to take advantage of that outage and do some work ourselves. So what our crews are going to be doing is replacing a cross arm on the Lyle transmission that we found last year that had some storm damage. And so we're going to have crews up on the hill above Shriners Farms, I guess, up there. You'll see a bunch of lights up there, crews working tomorrow night. And hopefully, if everything goes well, we're hoping to actually get Lyle switched back on early. So hopefully most of you will have an hour before you get up. Depending on what time you get up. Hopefully most of you will sleep in on Saturday. So the only other thing I want to touch on the outage part of that is next year, EPA has already informed us they're doing a lot of upgrades on their lines, and they've got a bunch of switches they want to replace above Shriner. So next year we will have two more outages on this line. We're hoping for short outages, maybe 4 hours. One to build the lines around the existing switches, and so they can replace them, and then one to bring the lines back into the new switches. We'll give you plenty of notice when that happens. We're probably thinking same time frame, end of August into September. So we try to work with EPA to have these outages at night. It's not easy for our crews to work at night. Most of our customers prefer it at night. Some customers don't like it at night. We've had some complaints about this one tomorrow night. They didn't want it at all. It's hard to please everyone, so we try to go with the majority. Maybe these people work nights. I don't know. So anyway, any questions about outages?
Do you know if this is going to affect any of the medical facilities at all?
As far as...
I mean, anybody, is it just a high barrier area only, or is it even go? It is approached by Sam.
No, it is the communities of Lyle and Dallasport, and it also the Lyle feeders that come out of the substation are the Hyperion feeder, and then Riverlock into Appleton and Lyle Snowden Road, as far as that goes, and then around the Dallasport area. No, not even West Sam.
So when you do have power outages, because I'm sure we're not the only area, or it is someplace in Goldendale, I'm sure that you're going to have to coordinate with the backup generators and all that stuff to get that.
For sure.
Or do you just try to work? Did you work in that?
Last year, was it 2 years ago, we had two all-night outages in the Goldendale area, which the feeder coming into Goldendale, it's not takes out the whole, the entire eastern half of the county. So we take out, you know, everybody clear to, through Pickleton, except for Alderdale, and we have those outages. And then again, that was a BPA outage, but we take advantage of those. We have equipment that's failing too, so, you know, it's a good time for us to work on our stuff.
Do we need to be concerned about electronics and public?
I've heard it both ways. You know, of course, we've had people say we take surges and this equipment failed. And if I was going to tell you anything, I would say err to the side of caution. If you think it's sensitive equipment and you're not on a surge arrestor, go ahead and unplug it just for the minute it takes. You know, why not? A lot of the newer electronics are very sensitive. Big screen TVs is one that I've heard that fail a lot. They're so sensitive. To where the older TVs that weigh 400 pounds, those things are pretty much in, you know, stick around forever. So yeah, I would, if it's easy to do. So what else do I have? Ice storm that we had in January. A lot of people were not affected by it, but there was some folks in my area that were affected by it.
Sitting right here?
Yeah, and it's interesting because we were getting calls. Jim just talked about this. We had calls from people in Dallasport because they were getting blanks. And they didn't understand it when we told them, you know, there's ice on the lines, and if you live in Dallasport, you're not going to see that because what's causing is where the wind goes up over the hill. And you can see that cloud bank up there, and above that cloud bank, it was a winter wonderland. I mean, we had to call BPA, which was what was causing the blanks, out in the Centerville area. Their transmission lines were this big around with ice, and they were probably down to about 12 feet off of the ground, and they didn't even know. And we were out clearing lines, and we came on theirs. So we let them know when they came and cleared them. We had crews out for 2 weeks straight, working 16-hour days. We had four outside crews in at the utility. We lost, I was trying to remember how many poles, distribution poles. We actually got pretty lucky. I'm going to say, you know, 10, maybe 15. Lost a lot of cross arms, broken cross arms from the weight of the ice. And we're out clearing these lines with our ice. Maybe you guys have seen our pickups. They have the cages on the front, and the one guy rides in the front with the big yellow stick. And it's not very fun to work after a few hours of that and, you know, freezing temperatures. And we're clearing them. And what we found is about every other day you have to come back and clear them. And so we actually ran out of, while our guys were out clearing lines, we brought in four outside crews to do repairs because we couldn't keep up with the repairs that were going on in the county. And so that worked pretty well. And we were keeping up with it until we got the one night of freezing rain, and that didn't do us any good, and that tore things up. And over at the east end on Dot Road, we lost a mile, right at a mile of 230 transmission from one of the wind farms. If we had an anchor failure, it pulled the anchor, and once one of those big H structures fell over, it was like dominoes. We lost, I think, 17 or 18 of them in a row. Just snapped them off. And this is a 5-year-old line. I mean, it's a brand new line. The cost to replace that line was, it was between $750,000 and $1 million. The good news is that the utility, with FUD, did not have to pay for that. It was paid for by the wind company that owns that line. Well, that we own and operate it for them, but it's a contractual deal. They paid for the repairs, but it was an eye-opener to lose a 5-year-old line, you know, a big H-structure line. So we've been doing things to actively counter that in the future, adding more anchors and anything we can do now. So, tree trimming. One last thing I wanted to touch on. We cleared the two-phase main line coming into High Prairie, I think it was about 5 years ago. And the guys did a great job, and it's really helped with reliability. I noticed a lot of trees coming back up under the line now. We're probably going to be back out there. And we're really promoting removal versus trimming, just because of safety and fire hazard. We really want to, you know, and we try to talk to people. We re-implemented a tree certificate program where if we do removals at your property, we'll give you some certificates to go get replacement trees that won't grow up as high into the power lines, and we prefer you don't plant them under there. But that's one thing we're really going after is removing trees now. So, any questions?
Sure.
So when you do trimming as you do, do you typically notify the homeowners when you do that? Because we had an instance where we had a lot of trimming done and then we weren't notified. We don't know how they really got in.
Sure. It depends. And we try, if we're going to do an entire feeder, we try to send out notices to all the landowners. A lot of times our tree crew is moving around here to there, and you know they're all over the county. And we get call-ins or somebody adds something to a list and says, trees are in the line here. They'll just pull that list up every day. And if they're having a thing going by there, they will stop and cut those trees as a matter of cost to the utility rather than coming back. Is that the best thing to do? Probably not. We would love to contact everyone before we come. Really would like to have a right-of-way specialist to be out there contacting people ahead of time. We don't have that. It's probably something that in the future we could get better at.
Additional measures that were taken, we revised our financial policies to ensure that we had appropriate reserves. We have a rate stabilization fund of over $2 million currently. And we have also hedged out into the future to cover the risk of abrupt changes in the soft energy market. KPD's power supply is all renewable. Let me re-say that. The energy projects that KPUD has one of the issues that we had at the new facility, the steam turbine. The steam turbine was out of commission due to bearing failure. That situation has been resolved, and the steam turbine is back at full production. That plant currently is running at 20 megawatts, give or take. And to put that into perspective, the peak at KPUD in the wintertime is 70 megawatts. Our average load is about 40. So it's a fairly significant form of energy that we produce there and can carry a good, yes?
So sorry for interrupting. And looking at the excess capacity that we have now, and I'm assuming that we can't decrease the production level, how much of it do we ship out? Can we ship that out elsewhere?
We've been selling the HW Hill out into the market. We have some contractual relationships for constant supply to Snohomish PUD. The balance goes into the open marketplace, and the White Brick Wind also goes into the open marketplace.
And this is up and down the West Coast is what it is, basically? Or does it go east into Idaho at all?
It's a West Coast marketplace, okay. Wherever the recipient has transmission capacity to. They could theoretically move to California.
Is that a winning issue for us?
The wind project is, simply because the cost structure of that to KPUD is so low that it is a positive money maker. Currently, HW Hill is not, but that's a market situation. And all the pros in the rating agencies believe that long-term, the HW Hill is a positive asset for the utility and the ratepayers. Up until the economic downturn, all the projects were all making. One of the projects that I haven't alluded to yet is our 70-plus miles of 230 kV transmission line and infrastructure. We have long-term transmission service agreements with many of the wind projects and also the combustion turbine project in Goldendale. Those are all producing consistent positive net revenues to the utility and to the ratepayers. Forward-looking on rates, the board recently held a strategic planning session, and obviously we are concerned about rates and how you have low, stable, sustainable rates over time. We're committed to implementing small rate increases if we have to increase the rates, and we are directing management to take advantage of the assets that the utility has to the benefit of the ratepayers. That has been a strategic focus, to look at how we maximize these resources, because it is an ever-changing and quickly changing energy market out there today. So there, long-term, all these assets will bring dividends back to the ratepayers. Rates, I'll say a little bit about where the rates have been and where they're going. Since 2003, Bonneville has raised the wholesale power rates by over 75%. KPUD has increased your rates since that time period, 24.5 or so, something in the neighborhood. The differential over that time period is roughly $25 million left in your pockets. The rates today are 14% less than they would have been otherwise absent the projects that have brought diversity to our power supply and our transmission businesses. Any questions on any of that so far? One point on the financial side of the house from a high level. When I first took office in the 90s, and I won't tell you the exact date, it'll date me badly, but KPUD was a D-rated utility at that point in time. Through the improvements that the board and top management have made, we've gone from that B to a solid A. Our debt service coverage ratio is 1.4, which is a good solid number, but it's not so high that it takes more rates out of your, more money out of your pockets than we reasonably need to do so to cover our cost of payback
regards to the assessment by, was it the Attorney General regarding the liability of the CUD for the fire record? Can you speak at all about that?
I can certainly speak at a high level of that. I can't say as much as I would like to say. Obviously, there will be discussions, ongoing discussions, probably, you know, official discussions, actually. The DNR, they conducted an investigation that was not a full investigation, in my opinion. That's just my opinion. After reading it thoroughly, it was very limited in scope and very disappointing that it was done in such a limited fashion. KPUD and our professionals that we hired are doing an investigation of our own. And there, I can assure you, there is a lot more information that's going to come out over time. And it's not lining up well with what the DNR has been putting.
So is it just them trying to place the blame as quickly as they can on somebody else so that they can skate on that dollar figure?
I think it's fair to say that there is a trend around the state where the DNR looks to those with resources or big or high insurance coverages. And that's just a fact, so I'm not pointing the finger at somebody just because. But that's been going on around the state, and this mile 28 fire, their approach seems to be more aggressive on that front than ever. But we'll wait and see what our investigation concludes before we actually come out with some solid statements.
What about the Highway 8? Was she talking about that one?
I was talking about milepost 28.
Yeah,
okay. I thought that was. Yeah.
I was just wondering about Highway 8. That's still.
That's still.
Litigation.
That's still in the courts to answer the first question. Mm-hmm. And that, the first question is whether DNR actually has statutory authority to collect from the PUD. Okay. And then, once that question is resolved, if they do, then it'll probably go to court. The tree that caused the fire was a large double top pine that was fully alive and well. We had a serious windstorm. It took the top out and put it through a car.
The tree was about 30 feet outside the driveway.
It was what?
It was about 30 feet outside of the driveway.
Wow. Yeah, the PUD has no legal ability to cut trees outside of our right-of-way. We legally can't. We just don't have access to that. If we know it's, if you see a tree that you know is a problem, if it's a big, large, dead tree that you know is going to go through the line eventually, the PUD does have a responsibility to deal with that. And we do. Our tree crews are very good. And they will go talk to the landowner. And most landowners are very cooperative and understand that dead trees are hazardous to the lines. A safety issue. And they take them out. But this was a green tree, totally alive and functioning. We have these windstorms around here that cause all kinds of problems. And Jim might have some more detail on that.
Sure.
8 mile, or the Highway 80 fire as well.
Sure.
I'll turn it over to Jim.
If it's okay if I stand up, because unfortunately, we just get out of the office. People wandering around the room. On the old highway fire, the rules that Jeff has to follow is we are obligated to take down, if we go, they're called danger trees, and they're defined as dead, diseased, or dying. One of those three. So if you have a green tree that's outside of the right of way, it's not dead, it's not diseased, it's not dying. I don't think we could have turned it out if we had it, we'd probably get sued for that. DNR's explanation is just once the tree is apart, and if you take it down and you cut it all up and dice it, in that crotch of the tree, there was bark grown in there. So we should have known that, so we're negligent, because we should have known that for free. I don't know how we would have known that without cutting the tree down and opening up and looking at it. So that's our issue there. And as Danny said, there's two issues. There is language, there are laws in Washington State that require DNR to go out and recover the cost of fighting fires for folks that are neighboring. They've been in the water for 30 years. They have made noises about it, but they have not pursued PUDs and recovered those costs for what people need to be neighboring. Given budget cuts, I don't know if it's a magic time or not, but all of a sudden we have got two of these at the same time. So what we're, Dan suggested, our first bid is you don't have the legal rights that you think you have to even collect these funds from another public entity, in this case, the public utility district. So that'll be heard probably in October, I believe, in Spokane. It's a point of law, so they have to come up with trying to interpret what the legislation says, because it's a little bit, I guess, DNR's opinion is bad. I don't think it is ours, but I guess that stands to reason. And if we end up winning that, we're done, and we're not, then what we would end up doing is arguing with the negligence case. And our defense there is it's not dead, it's not diseased, it's not dying. If the legislature wants us to address double drop trees, we could do that, but we would need the legal authority to be able to do that. That's not that easy given there's a lot of double drop trees up there. I'm not saying safety reason or not, but as soon as you start doing those kind of changes, now you're affecting people's private properties on trees and things that you can take out. So it's never a simple situation. And I agree with Dan, there sure seems to be a lot of cost recovery since budgets have changed at the state level. We'll see what happens from there. The board has been very, very active and paying very close attention to the Mile Marker 28 fire and staff's direction on a regular basis to ensure that we're looking after your interests. I think Dan's right, before this is said and done, there's going to be a lot more information that was out there before. I'm not sure what else we're going to talk about. You covered everything you had in the list. So I think what I would like to do though is talk a little bit about things that we've been trying to do on behalf over the past 3 years. Rates is near and dear to everybody's hearts, and as Dan said, we went for a long period of time. From 2003 to 2011, we didn't raise rates at all, and that was the performance of the budgets that we had. 2010-ish through 2013 were difficult years financially for the PUD. My hope, and from what we've seen, is that we saw much of that as far as services that we provided and things we've done for everybody. But we did do some pretty dramatic changes. We laid off 7% of staff in 2011. It was a big deal. That's a lot of people. We're trying to keep the services going. And the discussion we had with the board is balancing being able to deliver the services, keep the reliability, do all those things with less people. We've got trade-offs to meet as a result of that. I can't say there's no paperwork. I know that has done this time. At some point in time, economies get better to deal with those things. But we're still meeting all of our statutory obligations and all those kinds of things. But more important, try to look after the service we provide to you. On an operations and maintenance perspective, think about what it takes to maintain the lines and the water and wastewater services for the communities that we have. That budget to actually operate the utility is this year is about $8.6 million. That number in 2009 was $8.9 million. So we took that all the way down to about $8 million in 2010, 2011. Board direction is pretty clear. Economies look like they're changing. In 2010, 2011, nobody knew what was going to happen there. At that time, I think everybody was assuming short dip and the economy goes back to where it was before. But the direction that we got was, if a deer jumps out in the road, do you slow down to see if it moves, or do you hammer the brakes now and make sure that you're prepared? And that's the approach that we took. We made some pretty drastic adjustments. And their foresight and direction of staff is proven. And despite that, as Dan said, we managed to maintain some financial ratings outside of this. It looks good too. Going forward, it's a tough, I'm going to say it's a tougher story on the cost side. So what it does do something different. My dad always said, if you always do what you always did, you'll always get what you always got. So I need to do something different. So, and we've been working on that, as Dan said. We did a new strategic plan last year to look at, instead of trying to develop resources and assets to bring in more revenues to help offset our rates, ensure that we're taking full advantage of the value and maximizing the value of those assets. We'll talk a little bit about that. The direction is significantly different as a result of that. The other thing is then focus internal. Like I said, we took $150,000 a year of the operations budget and still deliver the things that we've been doing. So as we look forward now, on the cost side of things, things are tight. At breakfast, breakfast and coffee with one of the foremen the other morning down at Lake Salmon, and the Commissioner Knowles called me a tight one, I think is what he said. I haven't heard that before. I guess I'm a bad reputation to have it, I guess. I guess probably more than that is, as we look forward in time, what it looks like to us is that Bonneville is currently forecasting their rates for the next 2-year rate period are going to be 6.8%. That covers 2 years, so that gets you 12% a year. It's higher than what we would like them to be due to the cost of business, but so be it. The challenge that we're going to have as staff is whether or not we can just absorb that cost. To put that in perspective, our BPA costs are like $12 million a year. So 8% increase next year is $900,000, close to $1 million. Increase in cost as of October 1, it just goes up. I'm not sure if we can absorb that without passing those along. So those will be discussions when we get to budgets this year about how we do that, whether we change what we're doing, whether we can find more value. So I guess where I'm going with this is the board, I think, has shown a lot of leadership in driving us as staff to perform with what we have. As we go forward, my focus then is I've done what I think we can do as staff. Last year, managers brought our operating budget in about $700,000 below budget, just operating stuff. They managed to do this stuff, but they're continuing. So as we look forward, that's a tough thing to do. So really then it turns into, so what are we going to do, what's important, and how do we find more value? So I'm just going to give you a full example. Whether we go this route, I don't know. Dan mentioned a bunch of the renewable projects, and one of those is the natural gas project, the HWO project out in Moscow. Currently generates rate and range of $9 million a year of revenue for the utility. Out of a total budget, revenues are around 46 million dollars, somewhere in that range. It's a pretty good percentage. So that product right now, we've got contracts. The off-taker happens to be reselling into California, so there's a renewable energy credit, and that's where the value comes over and above this regular power. That output was sold for 2014, part of it sold for 2015 and 2016, pre-sold already. We've had just the power side, but that renewable energy credit value is still up there for us to recover over the rest of 2016. Given the changes in the marketplaces and what we've seen for those wholesale prices, those prices are about half what they were 2009. Well, think about that. You run a business and your product goes from, in this case, $60 to $30. That's a rather fundamental difference. Commissioner Duncan mentioned when you build a thing like landfill, it's a long-term proposition. It's tough to do with big capital projects with money rather than boxes. So what we've been looking at then is there another way to use that fuel, the methane that's generated by the landfill? Is there another way to use that for more value? And one of those areas is potentially what's called renewable natural gas. I think probably you've heard or seen, you go down to some of the urban areas, bus fleets are now propane for natural gas. And the reason is that it's a significant cost difference and a significant difference in emissions by running those buses on natural gas rather than running on diesel. So one of the things that we have been looking at is with the new federal laws out of Congress on low-carbon fuels, as of July 2nd of this year, methane gas is considered to be renewable and is eligible for credit. So you think about renewable energy. energy credit when we generate electricity, the underlying electricity price, and then there's a renewable piece, and that's how we incent people to actually produce more renewable energy than regular energy. Same thing with natural gas. In natural gas, find it's a renewable identification program. But the point with that is right now, it sure appears to us as though there is significantly more value taking the methane straight to bring it underground and do a whole lot of work to clean it, suppress it, and the last stage of the generator . What we're investigating is that once you get to that stage, if you take one more step and pull the CO2 and nitrogen, carbon dioxide and nitrogen out, you put a pipeline that's about a mile away from us. We've long wanted to bring natural gas to that site. And the reason that we would like to be able to do that is there's some generation equipment there that we could potentially sell as capacity of our market source and equipment. We could get more value out of it. But the value proposition is worth it. It sure looks like there is a chance to be able to recover enough value of the renewable energy, the renewable gas kind of stuff, to bring in a pipeline site. So now we make the renewable natural gas, put it in the pipeline, connect the value of the gas, the value of the renewable energy credits, and the low carbon fuel stuff, and there's more value there than what was going to be the facility. And we have a pipeline on site. Be able to use those other facilities as generators. But still, as generators, we'll have to talk about those. They don't say that's the only thing that we thought that they were able to do, but I guess my point is the board has been, very foresighted as to what I think we were. They looked out into the future for a lot of years and tried to keep us ahead. And this is one of those ones, so what is the date now? August 14th. The rules changed July 2nd, so that was 5 weeks ago. And we are talking with 6 separate parties about whether or not this renewable natural gas is something we need to capitalize on to bring more value. Trying to be ahead of that curve as opposed to follow it. So they're trying to respect my dad's thoughts and all things that he did. January and February, was in mind with that, the worst 10% water rate, how that affects you as ratepayers and us as a utility. That water flowing through the river goes to all the generators. As a hydro system, good water years and bad water years, we have a percentage share that we take for general. And when it's a bad water year, we get less generation. And that means two things. We have to buy more power just to plant it, or we have less surpluses to sell. And those surpluses are going to help offset your rates. So the first two months were terrible. Like I said, we were probably upside down about $500,000 in 2 months. That's just the way that good years and bad years. Like Dan said, we've got reserve funds, rate stabilization funds in place. And since that time, we went from one of the worst 10% water years to we went up and we were probably in the range of the best 30% water years. And it happened inside of 3 weeks. It just changed drastically. So on the downside, we lost some revenues on the steam turbine side, and on the plus side, we had some offsetting revenues because our water bill has come up. And the lower water bill went through the turbines we made for power and the load, and we sold that off in the markets. And if you recall, we had some pretty cold months there this spring, talking about frost. And around that time period, we also had some pretty cold months. As retail rates, were a little bit higher, and we used some of that excess power from the hydro system to get an insurance. So actually, it worked out really well. We had a negative on one side, and we got a slice on the other, and we got a retail on the other side. And Dan said, at least that sits there and just runs the transmission business line. We make money on that, but then it offsets your rates. It doesn't matter if the wind blows, it doesn't matter if the power goes on. All of those things are good because we get paid to have the transmission in service. Jeff and Jess do a great job. So like I said, looking forward, EPA rates are a big deal. It was in Portland yesterday commenting on some of their rate proposals and things we think they should do differently. How that budget comes together, we see how the rest of this year goes on. I think August is forecast to be about 60%, which turns into, when you do the math, about 120% average water, so I think we're showing this in the water of that. Irrigation lands have been working, we've seen a lot of work for that. We've seen a lot of customer growth in the salmon. It's been extremely busy, contributing some of that to the in-situ expansions, but also the city went to Santa Clara some water rights, so that has allowed them to do some construction. Over the past 2 years, maybe three or four years, we've been supplying mitigation water to the city of White Salmon. They were trying to acquire water rights. They wanted to release a building moratorium they had. And how they ended up doing that is we have taken some of the water rights that we had from the PUE, and we've done mitigation, which is a paper transaction for DOE, so that we have provided those water rights to them, and we sent them to us. So those are funds that fall back to the ratepayers of the county for the value of the water rates. But it also allowed the sample to start growing. Now that we've got our own water rates to continue to build. The other big growth area that we've been seeing has been irrigation, circles. There's still been a lot of stuff that's going from trees to great extent. We'll talk about the economics of water and crops. But what we have been seeing is on the west end, a number of wells, they've been digging, sinking the pumps deeper, which increases the load. And we're set to spend, well, it's not our money, it's set to spend for a customer about $500,000 extending the line in the Sundale area. We're planning on some of the orchards.
I'm not sure it's Mercer Farms.
My own opinion on that is just a sign of what's coming. So it just went from Alderdale all the way to Sundale. There's a lot of ground in the middle. It'd be interesting. I think the issue there is water rights. You can come up with enough water rights to get on the ground.
This is well water, not river water.
As far as I know, it's the well. What kind of mitigation these guys are doing, I don't know. The story that I've heard over the past 2 years is that they have water rights that they haven't put to use, and one of the deadlines to use them, so now they're spending money. make sure that we're retaining.
Just a question on the well rights. I would assume that you folks are joined at the hip of people who have investigated work in aquifers and ground level water and how much we've got. Is the ground level water, we've had some wells go dry up here in this area, and so I'm just curious as to what your thoughts are on that.
Do you want to talk about any particular systems, Jeff?
In Rimrock, we just recently sunk that deep reservoir in to be able to balance out. It was recharging, but not recharging fast enough. I don't know if that's a permanent change. It looks like the water levels have changed. Mm-hmm. Well, what was happening there is we were pumping and the water levels dropping and it came up. So what we ended up doing is put a reservoir in and lower the pump somewhat, but by using that reservoir, you didn't have to pump continuously so they could draw the reservoir. Mm-hmm. I know there's a property owner of Wishram. It's had some issues. We've had a lot of discussions with the individual because everything we've seen on the hydrogeology studies, the spring that he's got going dry is in a different aquifer than what that is. And those are tough to tell, so we spent a lot of time trying to determine where the aquifers are in this case.
I was just wondering how active KPUD was in working with geologists, et cetera, really trying to determine the nature of the aquifers that we have in Clickahatchee. I mean, obviously we have to share that with other counties, but I'm just trying to determine that if we're seeing overall a decreasing level of water in the soil because of just more usage or
demand. Our experience, as I answer your questions two ways, the first is we're very active with either geologists, but in the areas where we have water systems, we do a lot of work with those. I'm not aware that there's any major trends in the systems that we have. I do know the aquifer north end of Alderdale Road, that level is going down significantly. The reason you see it is they're continually increasing pump sizes because you're going to those, whether that's a permanent solution or not. It's a long ways from this point.
Just wondering if we're running out of groundwater for the county.
Haven't seen the overall trend, I guess, is the answer for the communities that we're working on now.
I think that's a really hard question to answer because where he's talking about is right along the edge of the river. This has nothing to do with our situation up here. So when water levels change, it's pretty somewhat site specific. It's
extreme.
I don't think you can talk about Sundale and High Prairie in the same sentence. It's a very different situation. And all those kind of river bottom lands along the Columbia, I mean, that could be really productive orchards and agricultural lands. And that's very different than up here.
We've got lots of cases where you've got wells for a mile apart and not even the same aquifer. I guess my point is the only thing I can offer of the water systems in the areas we're active, we don't see a trend that anything is dropping. My own feeling is probably along the lines of here. We've got a spring at our place too, we're significantly less water than we've ever used to have.
The trend here is it's going down, but it's not related
to it. It's not related to it.
One resource that might be able to address your question, I don't know which YROC or water resource in area you are in. I think the Goldendale area is YROC 30, and I don't know if you're in that water resource area or not, but they may have some studies done by professionals on a more general basis that give you some trend lines for your specific area, because as Fred said, all these areas are all geologically different and hydrologically.
It would be great to get a name and a contact number just to get that conversation because we would like to know up in this area.
Well, these water resource, there are committees that are local. Fred, you may know a committee here that serves this area.
About 10 years ago or so, there was a big study and we were grouped with Centerville. And then it was pointed out that Swale Canyon is a major barrier, and we're totally different and unique, so we are truly a unique area here.
I'm just kidding.
But there probably is a committee that covers this area, I would think. Most of the counties.
Can I talk to you after the program and find out who I just start burrowing in and make contacts with?
Talk to Dave McClure at the county.
Dave who?
McClure.
We can get you some contacts.
Please.
Like, whether, if I get your number, we can get a direct, or we can run it back, and we'll be happy to work with that.
Can you also address the KPUD relationship with solar power? I know that you folks used to have some programs going. Is that still active?
For residential?
For residential, yes.
Net metering is the program, and yes, it's still active. Okay. But the fundamental idea of net metering is you try to size the generation. So solar, hydro, we also wind as well. Try to size that so that over the course of the year, the amount of energy you use is roughly equivalent to the amount of energy that's generated on your system. And then the PUD has to matter. You know, if you did that, normally you do a solar type project if you're off the grid. You need batteries, or when the sun goes down, it'll